All right. Well, there's a lot more people here than I was expecting. This is it's a good turnout. Welcome to the most anticipated, what I believe the most anticipated session of the entire week, the last one. It's definitely been a long week for some of you. I did this in February, and I know how intense going through all of the stuff that they basically take your head and crack it open and start shoving things into it left and right, and by the time you get home, you have no idea what you learned, and 3 months later, you start remembering everything again when you come out of the coma. But so what builds, I think what drives us as developers is learning new things and taking all the things, all the great things you've been learning this week, like, you know, learning about Cordova and Arduino and promises and scope and JavaScript, jQuery, HTML5, right? We've gone through all these different pieces, and that's really what drives us, is that learning new technologies, learning how to build things, except for when it comes to building furniture. So we've all been there before, right? We get this new, beautiful desk that we go to the store, we buy it, comes in a big square box, and you get it home, and there's about 200 pieces inside this box, all working together like a very intricate puzzle, all focused on one important thing, which is holding up your gaming PC. So inside the box, all these pieces spread out everywhere, you get everything all ready to go, but you're missing one very important piece. So that one important piece is the instruction manual. Oh, wow. So that's kind of scary, right? All these different pieces, they all fit together in different ways, but as a typical engineer, I would look at that as something of a challenge, not an obstacle. I'd start comparing things, laying it out, getting it really organized, figuring out all the different common parts and how they all fit together. And over the next few hours, and a whole lot of cussing, I put together this beautiful desk that was just absolutely amazing. I get my machine on there, and in the middle of mining a few blocks in Minecraft, disaster strikes. So now instead of one beautiful glass table, I have 1,000. So there were 4 extra parts, right? I mean, what was I supposed to do with those? They seemed like they were pretty non-important. Now, unfortunately, in the world of development, this is a very common occurrence, right? APIs, code libraries, products, they're all out there ready for you to use, ready for you to consume, ready for you to build on, but they lack documentation. Or worse, they have poor documentation. So over the next few minutes, we're going to talk about what kind of things you can do to help drive adoption of what you've built. Because ultimately, that's the goal. You don't build things just so you can learn how to use things. Sometimes we do. But ultimately, the goal is you're building something to be of value to somebody else. So I have a Bitly bundle out there for you. And if you want to go there, this will have all the references as well as a link to the slide deck. And I'm going to leave it down there in the bottom right corner. And then on the bottom left side is my Twitter handle if you want to tell me how wrong I am. I'm finding this weekend, by the way, that documentation is an extremely volatile topic, a lot more than I ever would have expected. So you can get into some debates that are pretty heated. It's interesting. Okay, so let's move on. So every project we build has some sort of parameters, business rules, requirements. Somebody has given those to us, whether it's a client, a community, a work. And we go through that project and we spend every waking hour building it out, making it absolutely perfect, going through 2 revisions, completely refactoring it, tons of QA time, right? Or reality is, we have to build something in about half the time it actually takes, alongside of two projects that are already behind. So a lot of us get to the end of a project and we built it out as clean as we can, as best as we know, and we kind of get to the point in documentation, it's like, well, why bother? Now, maybe we don't necessarily say why bother specifically or use that exact phrase, but we do tend to question the need for documentation after we've already gone through building everything out. So let's look at, and I mean, why bother really is the whole idea is of adoption. So the reason why you want to actually document is to break down all barriers between a developer and using your library. So let's look at some of the reasons and excuses we might use as developers. Top of the list is people using this are as smart as I am. I've actually had that a few times where a developer builds something out, hands it over to me, and I'm like, well, how the hell do I use this? Well, it's super easy, you can figure it out. Okay, if I would have figured it out, I would have built it myself, right? There's no reason why you should ever think I'm as smart as you are. If you're developing something for me to use, you already know more about that topic than I do. You know why it exists. You know all the pieces that are involved. It's really belittling yourself to think everyone knows exactly the same amount of knowledge as you. Don't fall into that trap. That's really just... Most of these excuses actually make me angry. So I'm trying to hold back a little bit. So yeah, don't think people have the same IQ as you. That's bad. So real developers don't need to document. So typically this reasoning, you know, means that you don't find your library or API to have any value to anybody else but yourself. And maybe that was something you actually wanted all along, is you just wanted to build something for you. But if we go back to adoption being the major factor of any successful project, real developers know that you need to document your projects. So the website Write the Docs, they have a little piece on there that I find really perfect in this example. If people don't know how to use your people don't know why your project exists, they won't use it. If people can't figure out how to install your code, they won't use it. And if people can't figure out how to use your code, they won't use it. Why are you developing something if no one's going to use it? Here's a fun one. It makes me irreplaceable, right? So what does that mean? If you hear anything I say this entire talk, hear this one thing. Not documenting your code doesn't make you an asset, it makes you a liability. You go on vacation, if you leave the company, you get hit by a bus. The rest of the team suffers because of your lack of documentation. If you hire someone new, how are they going to get up to speed on what you've built? Right? Is it going to take them 30 hours or 30 days? Because they have to go in and dive into the source code to figure out what it is you've written. If you want to be irreplaceable, document your code so 10 others can use your code better. And that is a concept that would actually scale. I don't have the time. That is 100% true. We never have enough time. We're always given projects on short deadlines, tight time frames, and there's never enough time to actually go back and document it thoroughly the way it needs to be done. But think about it a different way. How much time will it take you on the next project if you've documented this one accordingly? Now we don't often look at the same code over and over. So in three months ago, you built something that you have to go extend today. If you don't actually remember how it works, you're in the same boat as a new team member who doesn't know how your code works. You got to go back and relearn it all. So the reality of this one is you have to make the time. You have to beg your project managers to build the time in. They have to be realistic. It has to be priority, or no one will ever use what you've built. Just look at the source. All right, I'm going to get real with you on this one. This pisses me off, right? great, your code's clean. Do you want a cookie, right? I mean, this is the worst reasoning why not to document something ever. Just because you use the best code patterns doesn't mean I can figure out what the hell your stuff does. Document it. Don't just tell me to look at the code. In fact, let's look at what looking at the code might actually mean. Now, this is a few lines of code from a very popular front-end JavaScript framework. Some of you might actually already know what this does, but just by looking at a few lines, knowing where this goes or how this works together is not exactly obvious. But when you look at what it's documented as, this is a part of the ready handler in jQuery. 50 million different websites that use this would never use this if they couldn't understand how to get out of the gate. That's why documentation is so important. jQuery would never be adopted in the manner it's been adopted if it hadn't been properly documented. Thank you. Tweet that. It's awesome. All right, so let's talk about, so source code diving is terrible practice. Don't ever expect anybody to do that. If I hear you about you doing that, I will actually hunt you down and kill you. Please don't do that. So auto-generated documentation, right? This is when developers get really excited, right? Sweet, I can document stuff, and I don't even have to work at it. This is great. Download JS docs or Java doc and throw in some comments and run it. Boom, HTML pops right up. It's freaking fantastic. Here is, and I'm not necessarily picking on Fusion Charts. It was just the one that I happened to find that looked as good as it probably could look for auto-generated. So Fusion Charts, so they're using JS docs, which is basically a syntactical comment. It has very specific configuration. You put those in above each function. Or class or method, run the functions, builds out a bunch of HTML pages using some templates. It's extremely consistent, and 90% of the time, it's extremely difficult to read. The only people who actually know how to read it are the ones who wrote it. So there are literally tools to write self-documenting, auto-generated code. This is actually what it makes me feel like when they use them, though. It's really upsetting. If you ever go to like a Java doc site and try to figure it out, it's like you're running around in a circle. It's ugly. So here's kind of what that looks like, right? I'm just going to show you, just to show you. I don't actually recommend using auto-generated it right out of the box. There are some ways to make it useful, but it takes a lot of setup, a lot of customization, and it's not exactly straight out of the box as useful as you would like it to be. So this is what it looks like for JS doc and YUI doc. Java doc, very similar. They all have some sort of comment, parses everything out, shoves it into HTML. PHP doc, very similar. R doc, I don't think anybody knows how the hell to use that. I've looked. I've seen tutorials, and like even they're like, I'm not really sure how this works, but. So documentation is like sex. When it's good, it's very, very good. And when it's bad, it's better than nothing. So I've looked up Dick Brandon. I don't think the guy exists. I will give a nickel to anybody who can actually find a paper trail on this guy, but I found some dude that lived in like 1700s. So I don't think he's real. I have no idea who this is. Somebody else actually said this, I'm guessing. But I completely disagree with this. So when it's good, it's really, really good. That's completely accurate. Now, sex is bad. When it's bad, it's still better than nothing. But documentation, when it's bad, it is the worst possible thing you could ever do to somebody. There's nothing worse than being led down a completely wrong path. You get to a point where you're completely stuck and you find out the documentation was wrong and everything you built is complete crap now. So reading source code is terrible, auto-generating, mostly terrible, unless you really customize it. I think the whole point, let me go back one second. When you look at auto-generated documentation, most of the time what people are doing is checking a box. So they say, we need to document this. Great, we'll use an auto-generation tool. All right, done. And they don't actually think about the fact that there's a human on the other side of that reading it. So when you get to that point and you start looking at it, there are some definite good practices. So let me set one more thing straight. I'm not asking anyone as a developer to become technical writer. Okay, that's not your forte. It's probably not the best thing you could ever do. Maybe it's not the best career choice for you. Maybe for you it is, but for the most part, it's not where you need to be. Most companies actually hire specifically documentation writers just for that one sole purpose of doing this process. So the information I'm going to give you will at least give you a better understanding of what their job is and how you as a developer can help those people. But if you're going alone, you're going to have to wear both hats. So let's look at some cool stuff. So quick start guides, topical guides, references. Those are the main three components to good documentation. The other three kind of support it, but they're definitely good to have. So if you have a link to an issue, I have a problem, I have a bug, I can't figure something out, linking right to GitHub issues from your website allows me as a developer to immediately feel like I'm interacting with you as a developer and have some input into how things have been built. Support contact information, that way on a Saturday night, I know who to call to get code snippets, wake you up out of bed. And then FAQs, obviously that is what have other developers hit that I need to know about before I start using this? But let's dive a little deeper into the main three at the top here. So quick start guides typically are 10 to 20 minutes success. This is a quick win. Developer gets to dive right in, start building out a proof of concept immediately. This is the quick start for Vue.js. I was messing around with it for a project I'm trying to build out, and literally in 27 codes and one library to install, I had a code pin up in 5 minutes. This is a really good example of how to get it right. Right? This is, I want to be successful, I want to know how to get to where I need to get, and then I want to start iterating from that point. If you're going to require me to fill out a bunch of forms or do a whole bunch of things and read a whole bunch of pieces and it takes me 4 hours to get something up and running, I've already moved on. So topical guides as sort of the next step, right? So once you get that quick start, you're up and running, you're iterating, starting to get some successes, now you want to start learning more. So you want to start diving deeper into very specific topics. And whenever someone asks me for a very good topical guide example, I always use Ember.js. I think they're great. I think it's an extremely cumbersome, difficult framework to learn at first, and they make a really good job of breaking down how templates work, how controllers work, right? Then as you start to build on each piece, you start to get more and more successes, and you get deeper into the product, and you have more knowledge, you can do more things. It also helps you, let's say you're going back and you're like, okay, I really want to remember how to use views. How do they do it? You open up, drop down the menu, it has all kinds of pieces. Oh yeah, I'm stuck right here. You go into that guide. They don't have to be long. They don't have to be, you know, 5,000 words. In fact, I actually find guides to be more successful when they're shorter and you kind of get through each piece of that overall guide and topic as quickly as possible. It's the same concept as a quick start. If I'm going through and it takes me 4 hours to work on one section of a guide, it's too long. I'm already frustrated, I want to give up, I want to move on, I want to do something different. And then there's just straight up reference. My API, my client library, I need to know function by function exactly how each piece works. It's less contextual, it's not in an overall theme, it is literally, I want to go in and I want to know how app.use works. Because I'm trying to use it right now and it's frustrating me and I don't know what I'm doing. Drill down, take a look at it. Oh, that's it. I'm missing this piece right here. It breaks down very functionally what it is you want to get across for your project. So when a developer looks at it, he knows exactly what he can do. He knows pretty much what he can't do. And he has the ability to dive right in and get where he needs to go. Typically, you don't use reference guides in the front part of the process. This is when someone has already gotten through most of the guides. They have a very solid understanding. Now they just need to find something, search for it, get somewhere really quickly so they can learn this one specific task. So just to drive the point home, incorrect documentation is worse than no documentation. I would rather go in and look at your source code than be led down the wrong path. All right. Let's keep going. So Tom Preston Werner, the former CEO of GitHub, endorses a process called README-driven development. It's like I should know that. Concept is really simple. You start out by actually writing documentation. Because the first part of your project is defining what your project does, what it's for, who it's going to benefit, how it's going to get used. So building out a README is a great tool, and it's not at all as limiting as some people might think. You can get immediate quick start. You can get a little deeper with different topical guides as you go down. And then you can show exact resource references right at the bottom of the page. It's an extremely useful way to do it. So while READMEs feel like a small piece of documentation, they can actually do everything we need it to do. You're going to want to learn Markdown. Why learn Markdown? It's extremely easy. It's a simple markup language, and it's all over pretty much every project I'm going to talk about. Every type of documentation project I'm talking about uses Markdown. You're going to want to use it in a README. GitHub has their own Markdown rendering engine. So everything you do in GitHub is going to be written in Markdown and displayed on the page. So it's very important that you need to learn Markdown. There's tons of resources. It's not that hard. You can figure it out. A really good README example is the request library. So a request allows, it basically goes through exactly how to make your first call and then starts diving in deeper, gives you all of the different options that are available, all right in the README. It's very straightforward, very simple. So great example of that. Another way to approach the README is writing a template. So you write an exact template of all the different pieces that you want to have in every single documentation item that you build. You can completely reuse that every time you go in. Makes it extremely simple. GitHub Wiki. So this is a README on steroids. It allows you to start adding images, links, navigation. Every little piece it feels more like a website. It's more of a content management system, still based on Markdown. Seriously, you need to learn it. But it allows you to take that simple README and start to really blow it out. D3 has a really great wiki, and that's included in the bundle that I sent out. But it goes through, has everything there, has all the quick starts, all the deep dive, all the information you need to learn, all built right into GitHub, into their project. It also allows you to copy that into clone it onto your system, work on it locally, tracks revisions. It's a pretty good tool. Static site generators. Now this is where I actually have a little bit of a bias. I really enjoy static site generators. It allows me to do several things, one of which is host it anywhere, as opposed to needing to have a specific box with a specific database. Static site generation allows me to build it and push it up literally to a Heroku box that's completely empty, GitHub pages, anywhere that's going to serve static HTML files, it's ready to go. Seriously, learn Markdown, because every static site generator that I've found, and there are probably some that don't, but the majority of them actually use Markdown as its syntactical basis. So Jekyll is a really strong product, and it's a Ruby-based product, Ruby-based framework. It, essentially, you install the gem, build out your site, run your site, great, push it up to a GitHub page, and your entire site runs on GitHub. It is, they say get up and running in seconds. They're not kidding. It actually takes seconds. So one of the products that I work with at my job, FuelUX, it's actually an extension to Bootstrap. Sorry, jQuery UI. But it's all completely built on a GitHub page branch of the project's repo, which means it's served at exacttarget.github.io/fuelux. It basically just adds functionality. But it's all completely based on, it's using Jekyll. So if you want to, there's a link in the bundle that takes you directly to the repo that shows you how that's built out. And there's Assemble.io. So Jekyll uses a lot of convention. Assemble uses configuration, right? So it's a little less strict as far as where you put things. It's all based on grunt. Again, it uses Markdown. It parses all those files, uses handlebar templates, spits it out in HTML, push it up to your site. You can use, again, you can use GitHub pages to host it for completely for free. You push it to a GH branch, or you push the HTML files directly to username.github.io project. So I've completely built out a documentation site called code.exacttarget.com, and everything on there is run off of Markdown and handlebars files, and I pre-compile everything and push it to a Heroku box, and it's ready to go. Hexo is another one, very similar, same kind of thing. Works on GitHub pages really well. Totally easy to use, node-based product, drop it in, up and running, uses Markdown. So anyways, so what about some other CMS? CMS is very similar to the auto-generated. If you really want strong documentation, it's going to take some customization to get there. Otherwise, you're going to have a lot of headaches on the way. So CMS is, I actually replaced a Drupal site with the Assemble one, just because of the scalability and the ability to go in and modify it and use pretty much whatever technology I wanted. Not saying you can't use a CMS, I'm just saying it can cause more problems than probably solve them. And it again goes back to the portability. If I want to use WordPress, I got to have a MySQL database, I got to have a Linux box, I got to have all that stuff built out. It's not as portable, I can't just pick it up and move it, where HTML files, I can just pick them up, move them into a different folder, and it's done. So then we look at API specs. So this is another piece of documentation that most people really want to get into, and there is a few tools that actually will help you write better API specs and allow you to then parse those into your project to be able to do that quicker. Apiary is a really easy one to do. It uses README and GitHub to store very specific API documentation style. And then Apiary takes that, builds out documentation for you for your API, and it also provides you a mock server, which allows you to connect directly to that mock server and make interactions based on the API specs that you've built out. Discovery from Google is a really good product as well. It's actually what we use at ExactTarget. And it is a, basically it's a markup language that allows you to drop in all the parameters, all the responses and the requests, all right in there. What this allows you to do, and this is the only time I really appreciate auto generation, is that you can take all of the discovery docs, wrap them into one piece, and build out very consistent API documentation. You have all of the, it's one big JSON payload in the discovery doc, and it shows you everything you need. That allows you to be very consistent in how you can pull that data into your template and display that on the page. And then WordNIC, which actually it's, I think the product's called Swagger, very similar, displays JSON objects as a as individual chunks. It basically takes an object and then spits out API docs. All those pieces are expandable. They give payloads and response payloads and everything like that. It's pretty sweet, something to check out. All right, and without any other flair, that's it. That's the end. So if you have gotten anything out of this, document. It's hugely important, not just for you to remember and understand what you did, but to help your team out, to help the community out, and to drive adoption and make your project successful. So thank you.
Questions?
So you talked a moment about Jekyll. Can you just clarify for me what the relevance of Jekyll is for why we are documenting?
Yeah, so these are really, what I'm giving you are, and I actually thought about that as being a question. So Jekyll and Assemble and all those other tools, they're not necessarily tools that make documentation easy, because documentation inherently isn't easy. It takes a lot of effort and work, and Jekyll and Assemble and all those other pieces, they make it really easy for you to build out a site, quickly iterate, use Markdown to provide better samples. It just makes it easier, the whole process of it easier. It also allows you to interact with GitHub pages directly, so you can push your documentation directly into that project's repo, store it all there, and it gets displayed there. It's just a tool, and there are hundreds of tools, and you may find a really good one. I'm just giving you a few suggestions as far as which ones are currently being used. If you look around at a lot, I mean, Ember uses Jekyll now. Like, so many companies are moving towards, like, static site generation. And I think it's just because of the portability, the ease of use, the ability to put it into a repo, have community-driven documentation effort, that kind of thing. So.
Please give it up one more time for Kelly Andrews.
Yeah.